The foundation of that is your daily habits. It's creating winning habits, winning routines, and a winning mindset. That's the formula.
It is.
There's no way around it.
It
doesn't happen. You got to start the process. As an entrepreneur, I think like the number one thing is start. You never have it all figured out.
Yes.
It's never the right time. You never have enough experience.
Yeah.
But if you let that slow you down until you have it's the right time and the right experience, my advice would be like, if you really want it, you will figure it out. But if you're just telling yourself you want it because like you think you do, it's not gonna happen. You have to want it, right? Like people ask me like, what's the silver bullet? You can go through all these strategies and techniques. At the end of the day, I think people want one. We all want the same thing. We want to feel.
Welcome back to Max Out, everybody. I'm Ed Mylett. Today's show is going to be ballistic. So I am I'm sitting next to the real-life Dos Equis man, one of the most interesting people I have ever met in my life. This man has a resume that is too long to even start the introduction with today. And we're going to talk about that today, like life resumes. But to start, put it mildly, this is someone who started the company Marquis Jet. He ends up selling that to Warren Buffett and Berkshire Hathaway. Started a water company that he sold to Coca-Cola. He's run 100 miles in one day before. He's a father of four. He's married to one of the most successful female entrepreneurs in the country, and Sarah Blakely, the founder of Spanx. And most importantly for me, he is one of the most giving and generous people with his time, his information, and his energy that I have ever met in my life. And I'm literally, look at this. I'm getting goosebumps because I've been really looking forward to today. So everybody, this is Jesse Itzler. Jesse, thanks for being here, man.
Oh, thank you so much, man. I appreciate it.
Have we had good conversations off camera? Or what?
Yes.
Yeah, it's so good. I wish we were recording the whole time. So, you know, the other thing I didn't say too is I also think you're one of the greatest speakers in the world too, from the stage as well. So any of you looking for speakers, this is a guy that you ought to be talking to. So you're going to get a flavor for that today. So let's help some people.
Let's do it.
So we can go all the way back to the beginning. I want people to know a little bit about your background, because I think one of the things that fascinates me the most about you is your willingness to do things that you're not prepared for. I think like going into the unknown, it seems to be one of these things that about you that's very unique, but also is a trait that I see in people that win at really high levels. So talk a little bit about, we could start with any of the businesses you've had, but did your upbringing at all like prep you into being this sort of type of person you are? Like when you grew up, did you know you're gonna turn out this way or no, not at all?
I always was dancing to my own drum. My parents gave me a really long leash, which was a great gift for me growing up. They let me do whatever I wanted to do within reason.
Yeah.
And I always, you know, all of us, we always come against this wall of fear, you know, this crazy wall of fear. And you can either go to the wall and turn around, or you can go through the fucking wall.
Yes.
And I was, I always, every time I went around, turned around and went back home because I was too scared, I had crazy resentment. Or crazy guilt that I wasn't able to do it. Regret, not resentment, regret.
Yeah.
And every time I went through the wall and got to the other side, it was so addicting. And I was so proud of myself. So let me just give you a quick example. When I was growing up, I grew up in New York City or in Long Island in the 80s when breakdancing and rap and all this stuff was happening. And I was really into breakdancing. I don't know, I don't look like it, Ed, but you know, get some cardboard out here, man.
We need to do something. Mike, get some cardboard.
Okay. And I decided that like I could make more money probably if I went to Washington, D.C., you know, because the kids in Washington, D.C. couldn't be as good as the kids in New York. We invented this whole genre.
Okay.
So I got my friend Myron, who's my partner. My sister just got her driver's license, and I convinced her to drive us to Washington, D.C. And the whole drive down, I was having all that self-doubt.
Yeah.
You know, at a young age, 14, 15 years old, like, what if the kids are better? What if no one shows up? What if we get booed? What if, you know, what if we go there and I stink?
Yeah.
And so I was almost talking myself out. I was building the wall of doubt brick by brick in my own head.
Yeah.
And when we got there, we went to a little bank in Georgetown and we set up a boombox in a parking lot of a bank and we hit play and my friend started spinning on his head and he passed it to me and a crowd gathered around. And ultimately, after I did my thing, more people came. I took my hat and I passed it around and we made about $200. I paid my sister for the gas money. And then Myron and I split $82, $41 each.
Awesome.
And this guy, you know, he's counting up the money and he's counting up the money and he gets all the money and then he sprints over to me and he gives me a bear hug and he goes, Jess, we're fucking rich. And what the reason why we were rich is because on that particular trip, despite all the fear, this young little kid that was so scared, I went around that wall and I realized I could be rewarded. Mm. And I was like, I want more of that. Mm. I was doing writing sports songs after the Knicks song with my partner. We set up a company to write theme songs for professional sports teams. Mm-hmm. And I did that for a year and a half, and we sold that company to a public company called SFX.
You did.
And it was the gentleman that owned SFX that had a timeshare on a jet that invited us as guests. And that's how we got exposed to the world of private aviation.
So you're flying on this jet. Was it the first private jet you'd been on?
Oh, yeah.
So you're on a private jet and you take this flight. And rather than just enjoying the flight, you get off the flight and go, what?
No, first I walked on the plane and it was like the scene in The Wizard of Oz when everything goes from black and white to color. And I was like, people fly like this? Mm-hmm. We want to fly like this. And we literally were like, let's start a private jet company so we can fly privately because we definitely can't afford it.
That's crazy.
And we were
did you know anything about jets? Did you own a jet?
No.
Nothing. So you knew nothing about jets. You didn't own a jet.
But I knew that if we wanted to take two or three trips a year to go skiing with our friends or take our college friends on a trip or my partner had a family and he wanted to go away for Thanksgiving, if we knew that if we had a need for, not for hundreds of hours, but for maybe 25 hours, there's got to be a lot of people like us. Mm-hmm. And that's really where the idea started from. It's like, how can we make flying privately a little bit more affordable, more to the masses? Mm-hmm. And how can we solve the problem? Like, how could we eliminate all the pain points of owning your own private plane? Like, you know, the pilots, the scheduling, the maintenance, all that.
Yeah.
And provide all the benefits.
Yep.
And that's what we created, this 25-hour jet card called, which ultimately was called Marquis Jets.
Okay, so let's talk about this. So here comes the note-taking time, all you entrepreneurs out there. Because there's a lot of entrepreneurs out there that have these ideas. So that's great that you had the idea and brilliant. But idea to execution to business to profitability to selling it is a completely different idea altogether. How in the world do you get, you end up somehow getting NetJets to allow you to use their jets somehow to do this card, right? How the hell did that happen?
Well, first of all, you know, we thought about what's the fastest way to get from point A to point B.
Okay.
Okay, that was the starting point.
Okay.
And we realized that we needed airplanes, obviously. You can't have a private jet company without airplanes.
Yeah.
And for us, there were only a couple of, there was only two games in town, or one game in town. It was NetJets, owned by Warren Buffett. You know, they had 650 planes in the fleet. Okay. So we were able to get a meeting, you know, through a couple of phone calls. And in the meeting, we got thrown out of the first meeting in like 12 minutes. They're like, the CEO was like, there's no way we're giving two kids access to our airplanes.
You got thrown out of the first
meeting? We got thrown out. They literally said, there's no way we're giving two kids. He said, that probably didn't break 1,000 on their SAT, which we talked about, which pissed me off. I got a 980.
He got a 980. Just so you know, in the history of interviews, so he's 90. This is so wonderful. So you end up being on the same label as Young MC. I end up being a paid for free backup dancer for a few weeks for him. The people are laughing their asses off, I know right now, rolling their eyes. He gets a 980 on his SATs. I'm in the high sevens. I'm a 780 SAT, and we've both ended up becoming, you know, very successful entrepreneurs. This should give everybody out there hope who thinks their prior resume somehow dictates their future resume, and that's not the case whatsoever. And
right.
So you get kicked out. He literally quotes your SAT score
back
to
like,
you.
I'm not giving you guys 29 years old access to my airplanes.
Right.
And, you know, our starting point is we have to convince them. We have to have a lot of conviction. We're the business plan. They're betting on us.
Yes.
And the question we asked ourselves, I think, you know, the starting point for any entrepreneur when you're going to give a pitch, what's in it for them? Mm-hmm. What's in it? What are we going to say to convince them that they want to do business with us? Mm. And for us, it was like they were catering to a much older demo. And we were 28, 29 years old. In my music business, I had access to athletes and entertainers just from the videos and just being in the scene. I lived in New York.
Okay.
I was connected to that world.
Okay.
That was my demo and age group.
Okay.
So we offered the ability to attract much younger athletes, entertainers that we said, look, if these guys are introduced to your fleet, they're going to be customers for the next 50 years. And think about the lifetime value of that customer. Mm-hmm. Give us a shot. If it doesn't work, there's not like no harm, no foul. And they said, you know what? We'll give you guys a shot.
So the second meeting, they say, we'll give you a shot.
Put up your own money.
Okay.
You guys, we'll give you guys a shot.
Okay. And now, this is one of my favorite stories of all time, literally of all time. So now you get a yes, which is just incredible. The idea to get in there to pitch, to get kicked out, to come back in, to get a yes. Now the issue is, though, you have no clients. So right. that theory sounded great. By the way, a lot of people, entrepreneurs, listen to this. They got kicked out. They got rejected the first time. They've got an idea. Now they're in business, but they got no clients.
And by the way, we really didn't have a business plan because we didn't know anything about the space. Mm. And to present a business plan, they could have been like, well, we're not looking for that. We were the business plan.
Yeah.
It was like, we're going to make this. Look me in the eye, Ed. I'm telling you, we will make this happen. We give us a shot. I mean, that those weren't the exact words, but that was the spirit of it.
Let's stay on that for a second, because I think this is huge, man.
People buy into people. They buy into stories
right.
and people. They yes. don't buy into PowerPoints. You know, PowerPoints are just words. And we had a passion and a conviction around the idea, because we knew we can make it work. We knew if we had the chance that no matter what, we were gonna work 21-hour days, we're gonna make it work.
You and I are both involved in a business together that we'll talk about at the end, and that's exactly what we both did in this case. We bought into the people. It's like so super true. But you have this thing that I think to the extent that someone has this thing I'm gonna ask you about before we get into how you end up getting your first client, which is the best story of all time. But I think all successful people on some level, and to the extent you are successful is the extent you have this thing, which is that you're willing to step into spaces you are ill prepared for. So it seems to me like you're willing to, you kind of think like, if I get my foot in the door, then I'll figure this stuff out, right?
Yes.
Whereas what most people do, and this is killing you, by the way, I won't step into the door until I'm completely prepared, which is a total fallacy anyways as an entrepreneur,
right.
for sure, or wanting to become a rapper or have a music career or an artist or anything great. If you're waiting for a threshold of, I need to be totally prepared, then I'll step in the door, you will be on the other side of that door the rest of your life. So talk about that. You have this sort of thing about you. You'll figure it out once you get in there.
Yeah. Well, first of all, nothing happens if you don't get into the door. So you have to have to figure out how to get in the door.
Right.
And I've always trusted the process that I'd be able to figure it out. But like the common thread throughout all my journey as an entrepreneur in everything is I had no prior experience in anything that I did. And for me, that was the greatest blessing. Because for me, it meant rip up the playbook. No one taught me how to do it. So the whole industry was operating the same way. And I always say to my employees, Sarah, my wife does the same thing. You know, if no one taught you how to do your job, how would you do it? Like if you ripped up the playbook and you said like, how would I treat my customer? How would I go after and pitch this? That's where innovation comes from. Everybody else in the space, they were doing the same playbook. All the brochures looked the same, and we didn't know anything. So for us, it was a greatest blessing. So I think experience is overrated. It's important, but it takes so damn long.
Yes.
You know, and like if we would have waited to get 3 years on the front on the line, and this, there would have been 4 other jet companies, and we would have never have done it. So
wow, that's so true.
You got to start the process as an entrepreneur. I think like the number one thing is start. You never have it all figured out.
Yes.
It's never the right time. You never have enough experience.
Yeah.
But if you let that slow you down until you have it's the right time and the right experience, come on, man, the world's so fast.
So you're telling me you did not know a lot about the rap game before you got in it. You didn't know a lot about the writing lyrics game before that. You didn't know a lot. Just listen to this, everybody. You didn't know a lot about the coconut water business before you got in it, the jet business before you got in it, or the NBA before you got in it.
I would say nothing.
Literally
I wouldn't
nothing.
Say not a lot. I would say nothing.
It's incredible.
I absolutely And look, you know, I was fortunate. You know, we were able to, as soon as we were able to afford to bring in people that knew more, we were able to scale it.
Yep.
And, you know, but we started everything very small. You know, we always thought really big. And once we got momentum, we were able to ramp it up super fast. The only way that I could really find, you know, I had to go where wealthy people were. And I heard about this conference called TED in Monterey, California, when they were first starting out, that was attracting all these tech guys and well-off folks, et cetera. So my partner's like, you got to go to the TED conference in Monterey, California. So I think I connected through Chicago into LA. It's a 5-hour car ride to Monterey, California. It was a 16-hour journey. And I get there, and as soon as I get there, everybody, it's like Fort Knox. I didn't have a credential to get in.
No way.
So you couldn't go anywhere near the conference. So I'm like, man, I just flew 16 hours. I can't go in. I'm so frustrated. But it smelled like there was a sale there somewhere. So I'm like, let me go into the little coffee shop over here and try to like figure this out. And I'm sitting in the coffee shop, and about 20 minutes into my sitting there kind of like thinking, God, how am I going to do this? A wave of people with credentials come in, and they're ordering lattes and muffins.
Okay.
And I realized that they must be on coffee break from in between speakers at the tech conference. So they're all ordering lattes and muffins, latte and muffins. So the next morning, I show up at 5 o'clock first one there, as soon as they open, and I buy every single muffin. I control all the muffin inventory in Monterey, California. I bought every muffin. And when the first wave of folks come in, you know, they're like, come up, order a latte and a muffin. Like, you can have a latte, but we're all out of muffins. And as they would walk out, I would say, excuse me, I have the muffin. My office here, we have all the muffins. And would you like a muffin? No, yeah. What do you do? Next thing you know, I'm in a conversation with someone. He's like, and he said, he asked me what I did. And I said, well, I have a private jet company called Marquis Jet. And the guy who just sold his company called half.com to eBay. Okay. And he said, well, I'm actually interested in a private jet. Awesome. Would you mind if I have a sit down and talk to you about it? And I was like, absolutely.
Gosh.
I'm like, please sit down. You can have two muffins. And we started talking. And here's what's interesting. And here's how I built my career. He ended up being my first customer.
Unbelievable.
But he was the key, because I serviced the hell out of him. Mm-hmm. Anything he wanted, carried his bags. If he was going to Mexico, shock and awe. Here's a book of places. Here's a reservation. Here's where you can snorkel. Like, that's not the business I'm in.
Yes.
I provide time on jets. No. Mm-hmm. That's what everybody else was doing.
Wow.
This is what we're going to do. Here, I see your family's going. Mm-hmm. Here's a floaty thing for your two-year-old. Mm-hmm. And they would get that. And I just serviced them. How was the trip? Can I help you? Here are your bags. And he was my source of referrals.
There you go.
And then the next guy came in, same system, same thing. And what was interesting about Marquis Jet,
wow,
you know, it wasn't that we built this amazing company, you know, it was an amazingly successful venture.
Clearly.
And, but that wasn't the gold for me. The gold for me were the people that we flew, because we flew 4,000 of the who's who of entrepreneurs, CEOs, athletes, entertainers, and I was like, wow. Mm-hmm. Here I am, I'm 30 years old. I was obsessed with meeting these people and learning about their daily routines. Dude. So what I would do is, I would say, like, every conversation was like, what time do you get up? Yeah. What do you eat? How do you spend your time? How do you live rich? Yeah. How do you do this? What's a vacation look like? And I would take all these habits from these winners at the highest level.
Yeah.
And start to incorporate them in my life. And the things that worked, stuck. Mm. And the things that didn't, I got rid of them. Mm. And over time, built this system. You mentioned in the beginning, like, your life resume. Yeah. Built this system that works for me. And as I've evolved, now I have 4 kids, my system evolves. Because I can't have the same system as single Jesse, 40 years old and no kids, where I have the freedom to do what I want.
Yeah.
Now I have way more responsibilities, you know, with my family. So the system evolves. So that was the gift.
Wow. Well, for someone listening to this, and I already know what they're thinking, this is literally like an inside peek to like an absolute master class of how to do these things right here, everybody. And I just want to illustrate 2 points you made, and I want to make sure that I say them correctly. The first thing is that all of the most successful entrepreneurs I know, and obviously you're at the top of that list because there's been multiple wins. The reason I want you all listening to what Jesse covers and his social media and his content is because he's not only is he a mega successful entrepreneur, and also successful as a father, successful as an athlete of sorts, successful as an author. He's also had multiple wins. In other words, it wasn't a one-hit business wonder. This is a formula that has worked for him that he's replicated into many different business ventures. And you said something brilliant. The unique thing for the ones I see is they create an experience for their customers that is completely different than everybody else. I don't care if you're a personal trainer at a gym, you own a dry cleaners, or
doesn't
you own a
matter.
Jet brand. It's the experience, because if they don't enjoy the experience, it's not mind-blowing, they're not going to refer you to anybody, and your business can't go viral. It can't multiply, correct?
I always ask myself this one question. Would I recommend myself as fill in the blank? Mm. Would I recommend myself as a dad? Would I recommend myself as a business partner? Would I recommend myself as a coach? Would I recommend myself as a boss? And if the answer is no, why? Like, why? Why aren't I? Why wouldn't I recommend myself? Mm. And I always tell people, like, you know, like, people call up, like, my kids are going to their first job. What would be the one piece of advice? Make yourself irreplaceable. Mm. Make yourself irreplaceable. If you have that relationship with the customer, if you're so important, you're incredibly valuable.
Wow, that's brilliant.
But it's true. Yeah. And, you know, I ask myself a lot of questions. And that's one thing I always ask myself. Like, you know, if I go, let's say I go sideways with someone for some reason. Yeah. I don't very often.
Right.
But if I do, would I recommend myself? What did I do?
Yeah.
And very often, you know, it's I'm okay with it. And mm-hmm. if it's something that I did, then I want to get in front of it and apologize yeah. or address it internally yep. so it doesn't happen again.
Yep.
You mentioned something about success. Mm-hmm. And, you know, everybody has multiple definitions of success. Mm-hmm. If you ask 100 people, you might get 100 answers. Yeah. But you touched on something I think is important to the listeners. And to me, I have a lot of different definitions. Success isn't being good in one bucket. It's not about, like, I made all this money, you know, and I know, oh, it's easy for you to say. No, success is not about being good in one bucket. It's about being good in all the buckets.
Yeah.
All the buckets. Mm-hmm. It's about being a good dad. It's about being, you know, good to your employees. It's about giving back in the charity bucket. It's about doing the right thing when you do it. It's about standing up for something that you see is wrong. Mm-hmm. That's success. When I see people that are mega wealthy, they're just fucking wealthy.
Yes.
No, they're just wealthy.
Yeah.
That's not what it looks like. Mm-hmm. And you don't have to be wealthy. If you're struggling in one area, you can still be good in all the other areas.
So true, man.
You can't spiral down because success, the way you look at it, isn't happening. Mm. Well, then go be successful in the other buckets and fill up your plate.
And then what it does too, by the way, like I can feel you coming at me with that because you feel so strong about it. Your physiology changed too. But what also happens is when you, and you talk a lot about this, but when you get wins in other areas, you get life momentum.
Oh.
And people just, I did a training on this the other day, but like you're, to me, I look at you, I go, okay, look, the thing you said about associating with these people and their habits, I didn't have a jet card company, but I joined the club where I could meet these kinds of guys. What is your schedule? What's your workout routine? How do you eat? What do you think about? How do you talk?
I'm sorry to interrupt you. Habits, you're getting me all fired up. Yes. Everything comes around your day.
Yeah.
We're talking about all these successes. They took years.
Yes.
Years.
Yes.
I remember walking into the president of Coca-Cola about the Zico thing. He's like, it takes 8 years to build a brand in this country. Of course, there's get rich quick things and now it's a little faster, but it takes time. But what the foundation of that is your daily habits. Yeah. It's creating winning habits, winning routines, and a winning mindset. Mm-hmm. That's the formula.
It is.
There's no way around it.
It
doesn't happen without that.
One of the unique things for me, because I completely agree, one of the things unique about you and I is we both will be creating this content for a while, and then when we looked at each other's stuff, we're like, my God, we so believe the same things. We say it a little bit differently, but we so believe the same things. One of the unbelievable things about social media or podcasts like this is that you kind of can peek into what you had at Marquis Jets doing this. If someone follows you on Instagram or follows myself, you get access nowadays to something you and I never had. You can get access daily to some of the most successful entrepreneurs in the world, or fitness people, or parents, or people of faith, or whatever your area is, through digital connection now. It's not the same as live, but it's incredible the information you can tap into now.
You are my virtual mentor. No, you are. I mean, I'm in tune to what you say. It resonates deeply with me.
Thank you.
You're in it for the right reasons. Like, there's a lot of reasons why the things you say really have stickiness with me.
Thank you.
But you're to millions of people, you're a virtual mentor, and that's exactly your point.
Yeah.
And we didn't have that growing up.
No,
we didn't. Our mentor was my dad and anyone in my small town.
Yeah, me too. Don't you think part of your life, Jesse, that you got some life momentum going though, right? I mean, the journey is, I think it's the most, I mean, you're a young man, but I think it's the most remarkable journey that anybody I've talked to, because of the breadth of different areas. It's just bananas to me. So let's even move out of one for me. Let's go to another thing, because I just would love the formula, because you talked about the formula. So you have these wins in business, which we'll talk about more of them in a minute. But then you go, I'm gonna go run like ultra marathons. This guy's run 100 miles in a day. There's some stat like 36,000 miles you've run in 25 years. Is that right?
Yeah.
What? Like, do you hear that?
It's just consistency, though. I know the number's big, and I'm proud of it. But it's because, you know what, Ed? It's just part of my lifestyle. So again, we talk about daily habits.
Yes.
I have a very, very unique lifestyle that's worked for me.
Yeah.
I only eat fruit until noon. I've been doing that for 27 years unwaveringly. Mm. I'm happy to talk about that. I run every
day.
Why? Because it's all about energy.
Okay.
And you use more energy to digest food than everything else you'll do in your life combined. Mm. You'll eat about 70 tons of food in your lifetime. And to digest all that food takes a lot of energy. So if you could streamline your digestion and use less energy for digestion, you'd have more energy to have a vibrant life, to deal with infection, disease, and I have boundless energy. I mean, knock on wood.
You have boundless energy. And by the way, here's how real this is. When he showed up at my house today, he's like, someone's dropping off food, right? Like, he's that meticulous about what he's going to put into his body. I also enjoy on your social, by the way, the tips she gives on Instagram about the different things that are in some of the foods we eat that harm us so badly, too.
Think about this. I'm going to tell you why it's so important to me.
Okay.
Let's say you're a billionaire.
Yeah.
Okay? You have $1 billion. You got the helicopters, the farm, Laguna. You got all this stuff. You own sports teams and everything. And you're on a beautiful island in Hawaii with 9 Victoria's Secret models feeding you grapes, Ed, and massaging your feet, and life is good. Except you got a sore throat. And every time you swallow, it kills. The house, the planes, the masseuses, the grapes, none of that matters. All you want to do is get rid of your sore throat.
Yeah.
That's how important health is.
So true.
And there's a famous quote, if you have health, you have hope. If you have hope, you have everything. So nothing means anything if you don't. So I take it very, 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 very seriously. I don't play games with that. So
I don't think you play games. Well, actually, it's funny. I think you actually, life has sort of been this game to you that you're winning. But like, you, I just got to understand something, man. Like, you do things now, and I just think you kind of take them for granted. Like, it's the same for me. Like, if someone repeats back to me some accomplishment I've had or something I've done, it just, I don't even know how I feel about it. It's weird, right?
I'll tell you how I feel about it. I don't care about it. I mean, we have an audience that want to know the story, and I'm happy to share it if there's value. But the way I look at my life, I'm 50. I'm about to be 51. You talk about this all the time. Yeah. The average American lives to be 78.
Yeah.
So that means I have 27 summers left if I'm average. All the past stuff, that's done, man. Mm. My life is this window, 51 to 80. Mm-hmm. That's it. And I want to do this much shit in this much amount of time. Mm. So I have to be mega efficient. Mm. I have to focus on the things that I want to do with the people I want to do them with.
Yep.
And I got to eliminate the other stuff. Mm. So like the past, when people talk about it, it's like, okay, but who cares?
Yep.
Do you care that the Dallas Mavericks won the championship a couple of years ago?
I could care less.
No. This is the window.
Yep. This is now, everybody. We're about to go into what I think will be the best 25 or 30 minutes in the history of any podcast you've ever listened to. This is why you're here.
Let's do it.
Right now. And so, because this is where I think you're literally my brother in life, like because we're both unusually obsessed with this. Couple things I want to point out to everybody, things Jesse has said. My best friends and the people I know that are most successful are the most self-aware. You pointed that out earlier. Just aware. They're in a bigger hurry. And they have a sense of, they want to bend and manipulate time, but time matters to them. And so if you're a 20-year-old listening to this, we're gonna save you so much in your life for a minute because you're gonna talk to two guys now that are about 50 years old, okay? And for those of you that are in your 30s, 40s, and 50s, this is about to change your life because you and I both, I think this is what defines me in my life right now. And that is my perception of time. And actually, to some extent, my thoughts about death and not being here anymore, too. So talk a little bit about how time impacts you. You said something earlier about I've got 27 of these left. How often do you think about this, and why does that matter? What's it do for you?
I think about it every single day. And I look at it in a very, you know, people talk about relationships in terms of all these different things and friends and relationship with your kids and people, but they don't really focus on their relationship with time and money, but time specifically. And I'm just super aware of it. I'm really aware of, you know, I just climbed Mount Washington in, and I got to the summit and there were no 70-year-olds up there. You know, I went wakeboarding. There were no 70-year-olds out there. And the stuff that I like to do, that window is shrinking.
Yes.
And you know, my parents are getting older. All these things are happening around me. Mm-hmm. You've heard me mention this before, like my parents live in Florida.
Yeah.
Anyone that has parents that are elderly, you know, if you see them a couple of times a year and they're gonna live another 5 years, you don't have 5 years with them. You have five times the two visits you see a year, you have 10 visits with them.
Gosh.
Once you start to look at time that way, those visits become insanely valuable.
Oh my gosh.
So like when I'm with my mom and dad, oh my God, like the TVs are off, you know, I am where my feet are and I'm focused on it. And you know, when I'm with you, I'm with you. Like this is a great moment. I want to be here. Yeah. And it's very difficult to be where your feet are.
Oh my gosh.
But that's something that I really try to do. I try to be super present.
Me too. And so let's dive deeper. So See, I'm this big believer, brother. The way you just said that, 10 more visits.
Yeah, like where do your parents?
My parents are older too. My dad's got cancer, and I do. The gift of his cancer, ironically, was exactly that. I don't know how many more visits I get with him. I hope I have 3,000 more.
Right.
But I probably don't. And so what happens, everybody, is like, man, you did that effect to me right there. So everybody, scarcity creates value. And so that's why a diamond is more valuable than a piece of paper. The more scarce something is, the more valuable it becomes in life. The more you begin to allow yourself through the prism of seeing time as scarce, I don't care if you're 20 years old or 25, listen to two dudes here. I think the reason we've both done so much young in our life is that oddly, we've always been this way. We didn't just, we're more pronounced that way at 50, but we were both a little bit that way at 20. We were both a little bit that way at 25. It's not that I thought I could live forever, but I had this sense of wanting to do things faster, of live my life faster. And so I want you to talk a little bit about, just for you, do you have this sense, like, I have this weird thing, man. Like, I'll wake up some Mondays and I'll go, how many more Mondays do I get?
Oh, yeah.
Do you ever do that? I do with my kids. My son's 17. I'm kind of like, I only have so many more days with him.
I do. So, you know, the challenge is so many of us, myself included, we live in routine. Hmm. And when you're in routine, the clock goes fast. I make sure that I create a certain amount of experiences. It's something I call Kevin's Rule. Every year. So Kevin is a police officer that I'm friends with and from Suffolk County. Probably doesn't make an amazing living, but mm-hmm. one of the happiest guys that I know. Mm-hmm. And I went to Mount Washington with, I took my son and his daughter. We slept out in the snow in this blizzard, like in these minus 40 sleeping bags, all huddled up, looking at the snow coming down. We're outside. I'm like, this is an amazing moment. I said, Kevin, how often do you do this? Yeah. We're here with our kid. How often do you do this? He goes, well, every other month, I take a trip that I wouldn't have done on a weekend that instead of watching a football game, I'll go fishing, I'll go to a museum, I'll do something. And I said, wow, like if I can't take one day every 8 weeks, once every 2 months,
yes,
to create an experience,
brilliant,
then I'm out of whack. And if I do that for the next 30 years, I will create 150 moments that I wouldn't have had. That's the power of doing things cumulatively.
Wow.
One of the advantages of having money is, you know, you get to treat your friends and you get to treat people, and that's the greatest gift and all that stuff. But you also meet some amazing people.
True.
It's the people you meet. And I was in a meeting talking about something with an advisor, and he said to me a really powerful question. He said, if you could leave one of two things to your kids, all this money or a wealth of experiences, what would you rather leave? And I'm like, of course I want to leave the experiences. 100%. And so that's defined this chapter of my life. You talked about build your life resume.
Boy, that's brilliant.
We focus on so much of our attention on the traditional resume.
Yep.
But we neglect these experiences. And the more you experience, the more you have to offer.
Gosh.
The more, right? I mean, the more empathy you have, the more you can offer to your kids,
yes,
the more you can offer to your team, your employees.
Yep. Yep.
And so I have really made it and you have to work on this shit. As you get older, creating newness is hard.
You got it.
Yep. There's no newness unless you create it. You're in routine.
Yep, you have to intentionally
do
it.
You have to intentionally do it. So like I'm aware of that. You're talking about time, man. Time is running out. We're insignificant.
Yes.
There's 7 billion people, man. We're nothing.
Yes.
So I'm very aware of that, and I don't want to go through life being the 80% version of me.
Me
I don't want to look back and be like 77 and be like, I always wish we talked about going away maybe, what. I don't want to look back and like, I didn't do that.
Yeah, me too.
So I'm just in action mode. I'm almost operating like I'm manic because there's so much I want to do and I love life so much. I don't want to miss it. I don't want to miss it because I'm lazy. Yep. It's not the right time. I don't have enough experience. And it has nothing to do with money.
You got it. That's what I want them to
not
hear.
Not Washington. It costs $18
exactly.
to park.
Exactly. So I want everyone to hear that. So this weekend, I put a post out. It's amazing. I put a post out this weekend. I said, hey, go do something new this weekend. Go to a new park. See a new beach. Go to a new coffee shop. Like, just do something new. Have a new drink. Eat a new meal, right? Meet a new human.
That's
right.
Also where creativity comes from.
That's where it all comes from.
And, you know.
What you just said earlier, man, I get so fired up being around extraordinary people who get it, because you said something earlier that was brilliant. You're like, I have this huge life. You don't have balance. What you are is present where you are. Like,
There's no way someone with all of this stuff in our lives, we can be perfectly balanced, nor can you. But these experiences don't require you to have money.
And I recognize how hard it is for people to break the norm.
Yes.
But normal is completely broken. Look at normal. Ooh. The majority of this country doesn't have savings. Mm-hmm. The majority, the divorce rate is 50%. Mm-hmm. Obesity is like a third of something. Mm-hmm. I don't even know the stats, but they're overwhelming.
Gigantic, right?
One out of three people have cancer and all this stuff. Let me share this story with you real quick, Ed. You remember Rick Barry, who played in the NBA?
Of course.
So Rick Barry.
The granny free throw.
Yeah, Rick Barry shot 90% from the free throw line, okay? One year, in 1978, in the season, he only missed 10 foul shots the whole season.
Crazy.
The league average is like 77%. I think LeBron is below 80 career. Mm-hmm. Michael Jordan maybe was 82. This guy was 90, okay? And he shot every single one of those free throws underhand. He didn't care what anyone said.
Yes.
He didn't care if they laughed at him.
Yeah.
He just kept fucking ringing up the points.
Yes.
Underhand, boom, boom, I'm good. Like, didn't even hit the rim.
Yes.
Since he played in the league, there's been about 2,700 people drafted. How many of those people have tried to shoot the ball underhand? None. Zero. Because people don't want to do shit that looks funny or weird. And it's broken.
Yes.
The way you live is you rip it up and you don't give a shit. And you're like, I'm so aware of my mortality. I hope everybody loves this. But if they don't, it's not, what am I going to worry about it?
Right.
I'm going to go continue to do what I want to do to get the most out of this precious time.
So good,
man. You know?
So talk about that, because that's the other cool thing about being aware of mortality, because you speak about this better than anyone I've ever heard in my life. Like 100 years from now, none of these people you embarrass yourself. And talk about that a little bit, because this will give you, everyone right now, you're so consumed with what people are going to think. And just so you know, they may actually think it in the moment, But long term, they're not gonna remember anything you did. Tell them about that. I love this.
No, I mean, and look, I have my fears too. I want to be liked. I don't want people, you know. But,
so do I.
But one of the tricks that I do is I walk around when I'm super scared or I'm against that wall of fear that I control, and it's stacked up. And I'm like, I'll say to myself, Jesse, nobody on this planet, I'll look around, is even gonna be here in 100 years.
Right.
No one's living to 160.
Right.
So what do I care? And no one in China or Russia, they're not gonna know that the speech wasn't great or this interview wasn't successful.
Right.
And that helps me.
Me too.
Stephen Hawking, one of the greatest minds of our time, predicted that just the way humanity is going, environment, nuclear weapons, all these factors, that in 500 years there would be no life on Earth.
Mm-hmm.
Then right before he died, we're talking about one of the greatest minds ever, he changed that prediction to 100 years. Let's just say for a second he's right.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just say there's a lot of crazy people out there, the
yeah.
environment, disease, Ebola, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just say that was the case, because we don't know.
Mm-hmm.
If you knew that was going to happen,
you're
telling me you wouldn't take a chance or take the trip or visit your parents or do whatever or go through the wall? Of course you would.
Yeah.
And that's how I look at it.
Yeah.
I look at it like, and you know, there's three kinds of regrets. There's the regrets that you can change. I broke up with my girlfriend in high school. I wish I had her back. I can't change that.
Mm-hmm.
That's not the case. I'm just saying.
Right.
Right? There's that's one kind of regret. The other kind of regret is regrets that you can fix. I have a relationship with my dad. It went sideways.
Mm-hmm.
I can pick up the phone and be like, Dad, I'm sorry, and fix that. And now there's no more regret. And then there's regrets that you can prevent.
Mm.
Okay? And those are the regrets, like you always wanted to run a marathon. I'll do it next year. I'll do it next year.
Mm.
And you can prevent it, because if it doesn't happen, you could have prevented it.
Mm.
So I look at those things too. I'm like, am I going to regret this in the future?
Yes.
I don't want future regrets. And I want to fix the regrets that I have.
Mm.
So let me get in front of it. Mm. And these are all kind of strategies that I use that help me get over.
It just blows my mind how much I want everyone, I'm just mind blown, because guys, like, no one talks about this. What we're talking about right now, you can go watch 3,000 podcasts, a million different speeches. No one talks about this because it's like a really vulnerable, almost odd thing to admit that we both think this way. But I just want to acknowledge something that you just said. Like, I think about that all the time. I'm obsessed with that. I'm so grateful for meeting you, because I know I'm not crazy. because I think sometimes to comfort myself from fears, I'll think, no one's going to be here in 100 years. And you know what? The Earth could be hit by an asteroid tomorrow, for all I know.
Right?
Like, there's all these random events in life that I'm holding on to something that doesn't even exist. And what you,
I just think it's so important. Like, the one thing that always gets me back to like ground zero is I get one shot at this life.
Yeah.
I get one shot at it. Mm. I want to love. I want to like give. I want to be loved. Yeah. I want to do good things, you know, and I have, of course, everybody goes off the wagon and this and that, but sure. I'm very aware of like, this is it. Mm. I remember I was saying to my wife, this race that I want to run called Badwater. And she was saying to me like, it's a 135 mile run in Death Valley. It's like the hardest foot race. And she's like, you know, why do you want to do that? It's going to mess up your hips. And then when you're 70, 75, you can't do anything. And I'm like, I'm not playing for 75. I'm playing for right now.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
And
are you going to do it?
Absolutely. Yeah. Because if I don't, it's a regret that I know I'll have.
See, I live my whole life. You haven't heard me talk about this probably, but like everyone, I want you to
fast forward to 75. 75-year-old Jesse is like, and then I'm going to resent my wife. I'm going to be like, you didn't let me do the race.
That's right. I do that crazy regret future thing with death. So I have this image where I go to heaven and the Lord goes, hey, well done, good and faithful servant, right? Whatever someone's religious beliefs are. But then I have this picture where he goes, and you've heard me say this, and I run this picture constantly, man. One of my greatest shrinkers of time. He says, hey, let me introduce you to the man you were born to be. This is the destiny version. This is the ultimate version of you. This is the maxed out version of you. I want you to meet him. These are the experiences, the love, the memories, the moments, the contributions, the people, all the things that you could have done. This is what you were capable of. Meet him. To me, heaven is I meet him, we're identical twins. Hell is I meet him and we're complete total strangers, right? And that's what that is it's future projecting the regret. What you just said.
So, not to put you on the spot,
yes.
But I'm just going to put you on the spot for a second. So, like, our existence, humans, it's like a novel. We have a beginning, a middle, and an end.
Yes.
We reflect on the beginning, right? So, like, tell stories about our childhood. Like, oh, yeah, you remember that? Marquis Jets. We're reflecting.
Yep.
The middle is like where we live now. That's where all of our worry is. Mm-hmm. That's where we spend all of our time. We think we're never going to get out of this rut. Mm-hmm. We're stuck here. You know, and that's where we are. And then the end, we often ignore. And let me just put it in perspective. Mm-hmm. I'm sure most people listening have not picked out their graveyard plot yet, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. You probably haven't. No,
I have not.
Right. So then you're not really taking it seriously.
Have you?
Yes.
You have.
Yeah, I've addressed it. I've addressed the end of my life as part of my life optimization system, which we can talk about.
Yes.
But like, that's an important piece. Like, my wife has to know where my passcodes are. Everything has to be in order. I want to know how I want, because like, it's going to happen. It could happen tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
You're not really dealing with it if you're ignoring it,
good
Ed.
Point.
Like, you're saying,
I'm
okay.
I'm glad you said that to me.
No, you understand what I'm saying?
Yes. Like,
this shit is real, man.
Yes.
You never know when it's going to happen.
Yeah.
If you're really serious about it, you have a plot. You have a plan. Your wife knows everything. Everything is taken care of. That's responsible. And that, when you do it, then you really say, like, this shit is real.
Yeah, it's real. Yeah,
and it creates urgency.
Yeah, that's another level for me. So I talk about it all the time. I obsess about it.
And I'm not knocking you. I know.
No, you know, listen.
I'm just saying, like,
do you know how much I love that you say that to me? I love when someone pushes me to the next level, nudge me, like, hey, brother, if you're really serious, you do this. That's what we do when we coach our best friends. Like, hey, if you're really serious about sowing your deal, if you're really serious about running this thing, here's what you'd be doing. So, by the way,
end of life is something we ignore.
Yeah, the next time we talk, I will have had that done. By the way, that'll be done within a matter of probably days. Like, that's just, I'm going to take immediate action on that.
Well, I'll tell you how this whole thing surfaced, if you have a second.
Yes.
I was driving with my son in the car. Mm-hmm. And this is like one of those moments, I hope I don't get emotional, but I'm driving with him. And my son, he's in the back. I'm in the minivan. I'm looking at him in the window. And he says, Dad, can I ask you a question? And I'm like, sure. He's like, what's a curse word? I'm like, oh, a curse word is a bad word. Those are words we don't use in the house. And we keep driving. He goes, can I ask you another question, Dad? I'm like, sure. He goes, is shithead a curse word?
That's awesome.
And I'm like, well,
that's awesome.
Is it even a curse word? I don't even know anymore. So we keep driving. And I'm like, yes. And I'm like, who called you a shithead? And he goes, my friends have been saying I'm a shithead, all this stuff. So we're driving. And he goes, can I ask you another question? And I go, sure. He goes, when I die, this is a seven-year-old kid at the time. When I die, what if I can't find you in heaven? And that really hit me because, you know, like the image of me not being here, then my son waiting to come up and try to find me and then worrying that I'm not here. And that really jump-started me thinking about how much I want to live, how important what I eat is, how important my relationships are, how important my time is, how important my kids are to me, and how real this window that we're talking about is. Wow. I have a 3-bucket system, and it will be too much to do in this particular, but let me give you two at 30,000 feet.
Okay.
I have, and anyone can do this, I have in a list of electives. When you go to college, you have mandatory courses, most of them you hate. Calculus, whatever. I don't want to take that. Enough, whatever that. I want to learn how to make money.
Right.
But then you have electives, the things you want to do. So I make a list, and I love that. So I made a list of all the things I want to do in the year. I want to run a marathon. I'm doing a documentary. I'm writing a book. Family trips. All the stuff that I want to do. Okay. They go into an elective chart. Then I have a list. We'll come back to it. Of what I call my sunshine electives. Sunshines. My sunshines are my daily habits. That is, and I try to introduce one new habit a month. That could be, last month it was drink 100 ounces of water. This month is introducing a meditation practice. Because at the end of the year, if you have 12 new winning habits, that's a hell of a year.
Wow, totally true.
That's a hell of a year.
Yeah.
Most of us think back to like last 2 years, like what have you added that's new? Even myself, nothing.
Yeah, if you're lucky, it's 0 to 1.
Right. So, and when I tell people that, they're like, well, I'm going to do 3 things. I'm going to read the newspaper every day. I'm going to meditate. I'm going to drink water. I'm like, start with one.
Yeah.
And then introduce the next one. So my daily habits, I have a list of them. And that could be like, I want to play with my kids for an hour. I want to read to my kids. I want to drink more water. And every night before I go to bed, I look at my list of sunshine and say, how do I want to put sunshine in my life the next day? I know it sounds corny, but that's what I do. And I'm like, okay, hour with my kids. And I make sure everything is scheduled the night before. It's like, we can't afford to wing it anymore.
Yeah.
So every CEO, top CEOs have 3 assistants. And they wake up and they come in the morning and their assistant hands them a schedule, says 9 to 9:15 here, 9:15 to 9:30 here. We don't have 3 assistants.
Yeah.
Most of us don't have 3 assistants, but we can't wing it.
Yes.
The night before, you have to have the day laid out. So I sprinkle in my sunshines into the day. And then underneath that, electives, sunshine. My electives go on a year calendar. So I schedule them. The marathons, but my year, it's already scheduled. It's done. I know the races I'm running, the trips I'm taking, it's all in there. All the stuff I want to do is written in, because I'm not going to waste away the thing. I'm not going to go through a year and not do the shit that I want to do. Then my life plan, my system would be out of whack. But underneath the sunshines and the electives is this big ocean. And that's all the stuff that takes away from the things I like to do. I have to get my oil changed in my car 2 times a year. I have to go to the doctor and get my colonoscopy at 50 and go get my dentist shit and all that stuff. I have weddings. All that is the ocean. That stuff takes away from this stuff. So if you are fortunate enough to have someone that can help you with this, which I have assistance, then you can do it. But if not, then you can assign it and delegate some of the stuff. But if not, this big ocean, which I went 48 years of my life doing myself, what I do is I get it all on paper. So I can, so it's out of my head to free up energy. And what that does is it gives me a snapshot of basically I have 15 things. I don't want to belabor the point, but everything
awesome.
From pets to cars to this, and it's all an end of life. It's all laid out. And I have this amazingly efficient system. I could walk everyone through it, but I don't have the time to do it now. But I'm just saying, I take it super seriously because you can't wing it.
Yep. And they can find more of the detail because I know a little about the program and I'm like, I want to...
I didn't mean to get off track with it, but I think
no,
it's important to
No, not
talk
at
about,
all.
Like,
I want them to hear this because I think people think, well, I have habits and routines or I have a plan. Do you really? Because this is what one really looks like. This is what a high-level thinker does. This is what a high-level achiever does. So guys, there's something that you guys should go get, which is called Living with the Monks. Again, I know your listeners going, are you serious? The same dude also lived with monks? Yep, he's also lived with monks. So that's why we're going a little bit longer today, guys, because I'm just not going to cheat you out of this. So what the hell made you decide to go live with some monks, and what is a takeaway from that experience?
Yeah, so I was just realized I had invested so much in my physical side, run all these marathons and ultra marathons, trainers, this and that, but I really neglected the spiritual side. I had invested nothing in that side. And I felt like to be the best version of me, I really needed that. And again, speed up the process. I could listen to a bunch of podcasts, which are amazing, but I don't learn, everyone learns differently. I learn through experiences.
Sure.
So part of my whole like kind of like build my life resume, collect these moments, and I was like, who are the masters? And I was like, monks. I got to go live with monks and figure this thing out. So I did. I went for 15 days. I lived with 8 monks that had been on a monastery for almost 50 years. And no phone, no anything. Total isolation from my parent, from my family, you know, everybody. And had a room about, which they call a cell, about 10 feet by 8 feet. And I lived there for 15 days. It was unbelievable.
Were you a meditator prior to that?
No.
I
took a crash course in transcendental meditation.
After you decided to go live with monks?
Yeah, like a couple, like right
again,
before I went.
So it's another thing. You're like, you're in the door. Now I'm going to figure this out. Yeah. I probably should learn to meditate before I get there.
Yes.
Dude, you're crazy. I love it. I love it. So did you just hear that, you guys? He decides to live with monks. He's never meditated before.
Yeah. I thought all monks were like, were Buddhist. I lived with Russian Orthodox monks. They were, I mean, the whole thing was insane. I had no idea what I was getting myself into or doing.
What was your primary takeaway from it? By the way, you should read the book, everybody. But
you know, it's so interesting. When I left, people asked me how I felt. And this is going to surprise you in my answer. And I had, there's a lot of takeaways. Mm-hmm. I don't know why, just this one popped into my head. But when I got in the car to go back to the airport, and I lost all this weight, I'd shaved my head, the driver said, how do you feel? And I thought he was going to say, relax,
yeah,
you know, quiet. The answer was proud. I was really proud of myself for sticking it out. And we talked earlier before we came on about small wins and momentum.
Yeah.
I realized that like it's really important to me to make myself proud to create what I call an edge. You know, like these moments that you stick in. Because I wanted to leave. Day 3, I was like, I got to get out of here. Mm. I'm done. The clock was going. It was like tick, tock. Every hour was 7 days. And I'm like, this is fucking bananas. You know, like, I'm like this. I'm in my room. I can't even concentrate. I'm going crazy. I don't know. Like, I had all these thoughts that, like, my wife probably hates me. She's probably mad. My kids might come. I was going crazy. And I have this saying that really, these two words that really changed my life, and that's remember tomorrow. Mm. Remember how your decision today is going to make you feel tomorrow. And I said to myself, if I leave, which I could do, how's that going to make me feel tomorrow? Man. A quitter. Mm-hmm. I didn't finish my journey. I didn't get to the end of the movie, which I've been talking about, that I live by. Mm-hmm. You know, so those two words, which popped into my head, you know, have been something that whenever I have a split second decision, I'm like, how's that decision going to make me feel tomorrow? Wow. You know, so you don't want to go for a run today. That's fine, but how am I going to feel about that later tomorrow?
Yeah.
You want to drop out of the marathon? How's that going to make me feel tomorrow? You don't want to go visit because all your friends are at happy hour. You don't want to go make the extra calls or go visit the property or go talk to the investor because everyone else is at. How's that going to make you feel tomorrow when someone else gets the property? So that those two words have really like, they're tattooed on my brain.
Man.
And
man.
I think about it a lot.
Dude, I'm loving this so much. I'm getting so much from this.
It's a really good tool.
Yeah, it is. You project into the future a lot, even if you just do it a day. I love how you do that because you're going to be there the next day. And so asking yourself how you'd feel that day, I'm stealing that from you. That's so darn good.
There's no stealing.
It's so good.
There's no secrets. Yeah. Like, you know, again, I'm here for 30. You think I care?
Yeah.
I'm here for 30 years. I want everyone to get the most out of it.
Yeah. Well, that's why we're recording it, right? So,
yeah.
Okay, so last question about another person, then a couple to finish. So then what's it like living with a SEAL? So that's another one of his books, you guys, Living with a SEAL. And so take them through a little bit, just really quickly. Everybody knows, well, not everybody knows, that's not true. Many of you probably know who David Goggins is, and David's a stud. But one of the reasons you know who David Goggins is because you learned a lot from him and he learned a lot from you. But you ended up, you knew David Goggins before the rest of the world knew David Goggins. And talk about how he ended up in you, living with you, literally, and then what was a couple takeaways from being in his presence? Because that's a lot different than living with a monk.
Yeah, I think, you know, we hear this whole thing about being around like-minded people, but you learn from being like around people that aren't like you and that have mastered.
Yep.
He's mastered a lot of things, the mind and all this stuff. I saw him at a race I was running. I saw a drive that I've never seen. He had broken most of the bones in his feet because he weighed so much running this ultra marathon. Yet continued to run to get to his goal. Mm. And I was like, if I could teach that drive to my kids, you know?
Yeah.
So I was like, you know, like anything in my life, if I find someone interesting or different, or unusual or the best.
Yeah.
I want to get him into my life. So I just really reached out to him. We've created this kind of friendship. And I said, you know what? I'm not getting the secret sauce over lunch meetings and stuff. Would you come live with me? And he came and he lived with our family for 30 days. And, early, you know, before, yeah, I mean, I guess a lot of, I mean, people in the ultra world knew about him, but
yeah.
Yeah.
What did you learn?
He's just a fascinating guy. I mean, I learned that I'm capable of a lot more than I thought I could. I have an extra gear. Mm-hmm. I'm a wimp, you know? Mm-hmm. I had so much respect for him, for what he's done for our country. Again, like, he shadowed me. We went everywhere together for a month. So I picked up so much. But I think the biggest lesson, you know, being around Goggins was just that I was capable of more. Even though I thought I was operating at a really high level, I still had more in me.
Yep.
And
I think that's what the people around you, the best people around you do, is they stretch your capacity.
Yeah.
They see something in you that you don't see. And there's a, see, the lesson for me from it is, and for everybody, because you said it earlier about podcast versus experience. It's like you built this muscle now where you're like, look, proximity is influence. Proximity is, right? So it's great that, by the way, it's wonderful you access social media. It's wonderful you get podcasts, because that's proximity to a guy like you they would never otherwise get 25 years ago. But then there's another layer of proximity, which is maybe you attend a live meeting with somebody.
Right.
There's another one where they become a mentor. There's another one when they become your friend. And then there's another one when they live with you, literally. So what you do is you pull the, and everybody listening to this, you pull the influence closer to you. Its impact on you is greater, right? And I think that's the lesson for me. That's why I want to pull you closer to me. It's like, I want you closer to me because the influence, this is more influential for me than what we did on the phone, than our first meeting. And the next time we're together will be greater because of the proximity. So that's the lesson for me. Guys, think about everything we've covered today. Breakdancing, rapping, coconut water, owner of the Atlanta Hawks, married to the lady, Sarah Blakely, who founded Spanx, right? Like, sells Marquis Jets, runs ultra marathons, climbs these peaks in his life, lives with monks, has a seal move into his house. It's just a banana story. One of the greatest speakers on earth. It's just, it's a crazy story. All that in there, I got a question for you. No one's asked you. What are you afraid of?
Oh, just everything's around my kids, pretty much. That's my biggest fear.
You mean
just,
something with your children?
Yeah. And you know, what's interesting is when you have kids, the energy, at least for me, the energy of around worry is very draining. So even though we're here, my kids are in Atlanta, I'm thinking about them. What are they, you know, today, anything happen? It's just, this is the way I'm wired.
Me too.
So I think that's a fear. And then the other fear is just like not living up to my potential. It's just super scary to me. I don't want to be 70 and look back and be like, I didn't do this. I didn't do this because I was scared because of the wall or whatever the reason. That freaks me out.
Does it? Yeah.
Yes.
What would you?
There's no redos.
There's no redos, man. You got one
room. I heard you say your kids are four. Then they at some point they stop growing, right? Yeah. 4 to 5, there's big change.
Yeah.
And like the clock now for us as a percentage of time that we have left on earth versus when we're born. It picks so much faster.
So true.
So it just created more urgency.
It's so true. It's so weird how I am. I got to tell you, it's like I'll watch my own time is interesting. I'm so bizarre. Like I'll watch a college football game still. Here's how weird I am. I'll watch the game. I'll see these kids playing out there. In my mind, this is so, my wife thinks I'm nuts. I'm like 6-7 years older than these guys still. There's a part of me that's still delusional. Do you do that?
I
know they're younger than me.
But you're reverse aging, so
I'm not. But like, I'm like, I'm only like 6-7 years younger. Then I go speak to the team, and I see their faces, and I'm talking, I'm like, my God, I was that age that long ago. It just went by in a flicker, and that's what happens, everybody, is it's just a flicker of time. Like, you have to max this time out. So I knew today was going to be crazy, but I want to do one last thing because I just think you're incredible.
Thank you.
And the way you articulate things, man, like it's so clear and so easy to understand. But I think there's a lot of people here who would pay a lot of money to switch seats with me, even if it were for 2 minutes. And if they didn't have any money, they'd give anything to get a couple minutes with you. And so I'm curious, if someone could have that seat, they switched with me and they said, hey, listen, I'm not where I want to be in my life right now. Whether that's spiritually, relationships, financially, business, you know, I'm not where I need to be. And I've heard you. Time's running out on me. I've heard you. I've only got so many Mondays left, so many Decembers left, so many summers left. I got it. And it's got me really worked up. It's got me wanting to really change my life.
Well, then we won. Because most of it is, that's the start of the whole process. Is like, I think this could be a good way to wrap this up. You have to want it, right? Like, people ask me, like, what's the silver bullet? You can go through all these strategies and techniques. At the end of the day, I think people want, we all want the same thing. We want to feel good, right? Like, that's the one thing we all have in common. We want to feel good. All this stuff, money, work, accolade, it's just all about what you eat. It's all about how you feel. We all want to feel good. No one here doesn't want to feel good. But going back to your question, I think you really nailed it. I remember, and this, if I can just share a 1 minute story, and I don't, I was with my sister and one of her friends at a dinner table, and they asked, like, what it is, like, what's the silver bullet? And I said, well, I don't know. I'm not really that talented. You know, I'm never the smartest in the room, that's for sure. But I always really wanted it. I really wanted it. And they're like, the guy's like, oh, well, I really wanted the raise. I really wanted to make $1 million last year. I really wanted the promotion, and I didn't get it. And I'm like, well, you don't understand it. And they were like laughing and mimicking me. A year later, we're at the dinner table with my sister. She just put out a coffee table book where she had to go get these quotes and pictures from celebrity around success or whatever, and get all these amazing quotes from people that she didn't know. And I'm like, Jill, she's showing me the book. How did you do it? She's like, I don't know. I had no experience. I had no idea what I was doing. I made all these mistakes. I would call the publicist. They'd hang up. I'd call them back. And then finally, I got a couple. I had small wins and momentum. And then from that, I got more. And I use that as my story. People buy into stories. And I would get more and more. And then I figured out, then I had time to publish it. And I called all the publishers. And this and this. And then all of a sudden, then I got it all together. And then I got a PR person. I put it out and I go, I don't know, through all, I just really wanted it. And I'm like, you see? That's what I'm talking about, that those clowns didn't understand. You wanted it. When they said no, you kept going because you wanted it. If you really want to change, you will change. If my wife said to me, let's go get better, let's go see a therapist, okay? And I didn't really want to go, I'm going because of her, it's not gonna work. If I want to go to the therapist, because genuinely I want our relationship, because why the hell would I want to live in chaos? To get better, it's gonna get better. So my advice would be, like, if you really want it, you will figure it out. But if you're just telling yourself you want it because, like, you think you do, it's not gonna happen.
100%. And it all comes back to the very beginning, Jesse. It's getting your foot in the door and then figuring it out. If you want it, you will get your freaking foot in the door and then you will figure it out.
And it might take time.
Yeah.
I never knew Marquis was gonna jet was gonna happen when I was a kiddie pool attendant. Or when I was breakdancing, or when I got dropped from the rap label, but I knew I wanted what I wanted. The script, plot change, whoop, got dropped from the label, whoop, got kicked out of here, plot change, got kicked out of the jet company, but this didn't change.
I love that. This doesn't change, the plot changes. This has been an unflippin' believable conversation. By the way, one other business we're both involved with, we should at least point this out.
Definitely.
So, Jesse and I are both involved with Outstanding Foods. We're both investors in that company, Rob Dyrdek, Cesar Milan, a bunch of other people. You guys should go to Outstanding Foods and check out Pig Out Chips and order some of these. They're yummy and they're healthy for you too. So we're both involved in that business, and we would be crazy not to take this time to promote it too. So
I love it.
There you go.
So we're everybody, business together.
We're business partners. We didn't even know it initially, but we are now. So everybody check that out. Listen, today was unreal. I got a favor to ask of you.
Sure.
First off, everybody follows you where?
At Jesse Itzler on Instagram.
At Jesse Itzler on Instagram. It's some of the best content you've ever seen in your life, and he's doing more and more and more of it too. And it's somebody who, like, you guys, you can tell today, you've watched me do a lot of interviews. You know when I know when I'm in love with someone and what they produce, and that's Jesse. And I just really want to thank you. I want to ask a favor of you. Would you, if I had one guest win a drawing, would you do a 15-minute call with one of them?
I'll do anything.
Okay.
Absolutely.
I love you. Thank you so much for today, man. Thank you.
Appreciate it, man. Thanks for having me.
I loved it. And so everyone, remember this, okay? Every day on social media, on Instagram, I do the max out 2-minute drill, which means if you make a comment within the first 2 minutes, we pick a winner every single day from everyone who makes a comment the first 2 minutes, and that winner receives all kinds of cool stuff. Coaching call with me, coaching call with Jesse, my other guests, max out gear, signed autographed copy of my book, really cool stuff. So make sure you're engaging in the max out universe on social media. And if you miss the first 2 minutes, here's what's cool. All you have to do is make a comment every day on my post, when I post daily at any time, if you miss the first 2 minutes. End of the week, we look at all the people who comment every day and we pick a winner from there as well, so you can qualify. And remember to share this. This is the number one show in the world for a reason. Fastest growing show and number one at this point because of the caliber of the people that I collaborate with there. It's because you guys have been so great at sharing this program with people you believe in, that you care about. So please do that right now.
Today was unreal, brother.
Thank you.
Heavy note-taking. I know you're all super inspired. God bless you, and Max out. Hey guys, thanks for sticking around. If you'd like more, click the videos right here. They're exactly what you need to see next. And if you're new here, hit subscribe and become a part of the Max Out community. And tell me what you think about the videos in the comments below. I read all of them every week, and I select winners that get all kinds of prizes, gear, coaching calls with me. Make a comment.